Hello, boys and girls. Thanks for tuning in and welcome to the Joy of Piping. I have been away a little while, and in a most fortuitous opportunity presented by our good friend Eddie Gray at thepipenook.com, I have content for a video. Eddie has a 1,000 subscribers contest going on. I'm sorry, we don't say contest anymore. 1,000 subscribers giveaway. And the source material, the response for the response, is right up my alley. So I couldn't pass up the opportunity. Before I go any further, this is the 2016 Brandon Brooks Pipe of the Year with a little 2016 Christmas cheer. And my Key Largo cup from Cafe Press and some coffee. So, Eddie asked us for the video response to share our top five favorite albums, artists, or songs. Specifically, the albums is what he was looking for, and I've been a musician for 22 years now. I started when I was 8, and I'm turning 30 at the very beginning of December, and that's when I got my first guitar. And so for 22 years, I've been playing guitar, bass, everything. And I've kind of developed some interesting tastes in music, to say the least. So narrowing down a top five is difficult. So what I chose was the top five most influential albums on me in general, as a music lover, as a musician, as a person. These are the five albums that I consider kind of the ones that pushed me in different directions. The only one that holds a very specific place is the number one slot. Everything else is kind of interchangeable. So for the sake of brevity, let's dive right in. The first album came out while I was still in high school. Actually came out the year I graduated, and that band's previous album was a little rough. It was their first album. They hadn't really put, I guess they were still kind of forming their personal sound. The band is called Alexis on Fire. They're kind of a hardcore, post-hardcore, I don't know how they classify this stuff anymore, a post-hardcore group out of Canada. And the second album was from 2004. It's called Watch Out. I think that's when they really hit their stride as songwriters. They're interesting to me because they use two vocalists. One of the guitarists does the clean singing vocals, and the main vocalist is a little more aggressive. I would say screaming, but that's not really accurate. There are some different things that he does in different albums later on down the line, but this album in particular was a hit for me. It was about the time I was in a heavy metal band. I was actually in two heavy metal bands at the same time, and hardcore music was kind of all the rage then. Everybody wanted breakdowns and mosh pits and all this kind of stuff, and Alexis on Fire just hit the spot for me. They were the perfect mix of everything that I like. The songs are really cohesive on that album, and if you're into that kind of hardcore, post-hardcore sound, 2004, Watch Out by Alexis on Fire. Fantastic. And that was a big hit with me, specifically because it broadened my horizon for what I could do when writing a song. Next on the list, just probably no surprise, anyone who loves heavy metal probably loves this album, and it's actually from the year I was born. A lot of landmark years here. Metallica has been a big influence on me since I first started playing, but in particular 1986's Master of Puppets is kind of top of the list for me. It is when they really started to come together with Cliff Burton on bass, and Justice for All is fantastic. The songs are wonderfully written, but Master of Puppets is a thrill ride from beginning to end. Battery, opening with a classical guitar intro, just layers and layers and layers of sound. Master of Puppets, an 8-plus-minute epic. Disposable Heroes with this insane opening guitar riff. It's anxious the whole way through. Sanitarium sounds like insanity. Oh, Orion as an instrumental. I never would have thought that bass could take the lead. You know, a solo from a bass player in a song. That changed my mind about a lot of things. And that was an album that, when I really got into it was when the internet was still becoming a big thing, early 90s, and tabs weren't readily available or harder to find at that point. You know, I didn't know that much about the internet at that time. I was 8 when I started learning that album. And when I was 10, I locked myself in my room for months on end and learned it by ear from beginning to end. So I think that says kind of the extent of the influence it's had on me. The next album is a drastic shift in styles. It's from 1977, and it is called Solo Guitar by a gentleman by the late, great Ted Green. Ted Green passed in 2005, and there was an article written about him in one of the guitar magazines that I was frequently reading at the time. I think it was December 2005. He passed away in August, and they made a joke about there being an opening now for 500 guitar teachers in that area. I was like, I didn't quite get the joke until I started looking into his extent of knowledge and harmony and theory and his grasp of the guitar. If you are in the mood to hear a favorite old standard, if you like Joe Beam tunes, if you like Beatles medleys, Send in the Clowns, a famous old tune that a lot of people will know. If you look on YouTube and type Ted Green, and that's with an E at the end, you will not be disappointed. It is amazing to think that one man can carry so much. I don't even know. If you listen to the album, unfortunately, he only released the one album, and it's only like 35 or 38 minutes long. And it sounds like there's two or three guitar players playing at the same time. And for to have that big of a grasp of the instrument that you could sound like more than one person playing, you've got skill. And I wish that he had released another album besides Solo Guitar, but I listened to that album nonstop, and that's kind of what started me down the path of learning jazz guitar, or learning how to do solo arrangements. The next one, again, in the jazz genre, is an album by Joe Pass. This album was actually released in 2002, and Joe Pass died in 1994. So I'm not sure exactly when this was recorded, but this was a live performance at a bar, a restaurant, a jazz venue. I'm not sure. But it's a live recorded performance. You can hear the audience in the background, but from beginning to end, Joe is on. I know that it has to be probably early 90s, because I can hear, based on the photo, which I assume is from that night, and the sound of the guitar, which was pretty indicative that he was playing his signature model Ibanez guitar. It had a very specific sound. Guitarists will probably know what I mean. I have to assume it was recorded overseas, because he rarely took any other guitar overseas after he got that one, and it has to be early, like I would assume between 90 and 92. Because 92 is when his health really started to fail, and I think he was touring a little bit less at that point. But this album from beginning to end is fantastic. Joe is always fantastic. If you listen to Joe Pass, you'll know exactly what I mean. The Virtuoso series 1, 2, 3, and 4, it's just guitar, and it's amazing. Unforgettable. It's all acoustic versions of, or I should say played on a classical guitar. but solo acoustic versions of love songs and ballads, fantastic. But Joe was really on this night, and I don't even think he misses a single note, and I listen to that album regularly. Like every other day, I probably listen to this album, just because it really captures the moment and the talent that Joe had. And the final album, probably no surprise, it is Joe Pass again, but it's Joe Pass with Niels Henning Orsted Pedersen. Pedersen. Always pronounce that last one wrong. Affectionately known as NHOP. Joe and NHOP had done a lot of work together, and this album is from 1978. It's called Chops. Joe and NHOP did a lot of work together. They were doing a guitar and bass duo. They toured around a little bit. They did a lot of performances, Antibes, Montreal Jazz Festival. They did a lot of performances together, and from reading the liner notes, it looks like when they went into the studio to do this, they chose a song, they chose a key, and they chose a tempo, and they just go for it. They do a couple of takes on each one, and obviously the best take makes the album. Jazz music recorded in this fashion always seems to be the most alive. The thing that sold me on this album when I first heard it, the first track is an old standard called Have You Met Miss Jones. So Joe starts, he does the intro with guitar, and they pick this kind of quasi bossa nova Latin type rhythm, and NHOP comes in and he takes the head of the tune on the bass, which to me at the time was, again, still a little incomprehensible. I'd never pictured bass as a solo instrument or as a lead instrument. He takes the head of the tune, then he takes a solo. As he's ending his solo, he quotes a little phrase in one octave, then an octave higher, then an octave lower, and then moves right into carrying the rhythm. Joe, as he's leaving the rhythm and going into his own solo, quotes that exact same set of notes right back to NHOP, and it just, you could tell there's some kind of telepathic connection. The best way for me to explain it would be to tell you to look up Joe Pass and Niels Henning Orsted Pedersen's Chops album and listen to Have You Met Miss Jones, and you'll understand exactly what I mean. But there was telepathy between the two, and the whole album is very indicative of that. They've worked together so much that they know exactly what the other one's going to do at the exact time they do it. So if you're looking for good jazz, that would be the perfect place to start. And that concludes my list of the top five, I would say, most influential albums on me as a musician, as a music lover, as a person. They kind of pushed me in different directions, and there are albums that I go back to. You know, sometimes the Alexis on Fire album, I'll go back and I'll listen to it for 2 months straight, from beginning to end, at least once a day. Then I don't listen to it for a little while, and then I go back and do the exact same thing. Same thing with Master of Puppets. Chops, I probably listen to at least two or three times a week, and I have for more than 10 years now, so you can see that these songs and these particular albums are kind of deeply ingrained in me, and sometimes I just play them in my head even when I don't have my headphones hooked up to my phone. So I hope I gave you guys some good music to listen to. Eddie, I hope I fulfilled your requirements as well as I hope I did. And again, thank you for the 1,000 subscribers giveaway. Congratulations on hitting 1,000 subs, and happy piping, and God bless.